you, Martin and Ed. And I'm sorry to disappoint you, but I'm not actually going to talk that much about Positive Money's flagship proposal, which is to strip private banks of their power to create money. I very much agree with what Martin said and a lot of what Ed said, although I'd pick up on a few things and disagree with a few points, and maybe we can get into it in the Q&A. But I think what I do agree with is change is so urgent that we need to be talking about what is happening right now and criticising it. So that's where I'm at, and I'm not an economist like these two. I'm more of a system change thinker, and so I want to bring in the broader context. So we're in 2017, and in the UK, wages have seen the worst pay decline since the Victorian era, and they've stagnated for the longest time in 200 years, or since the Napoleonic Wars. We've got a record high current account deficit, record high asset prices, record high debt to GDP, a lack of demand, secular stagnation, and record low interest rates. Stock markets are hitting all-time highs, and in the UK, in the last 5 years, we've seen a growth in millionaires by 41%. And at the same time, we've got 1 in 8 workers who can't afford 3 meals a day. Low-paid jobs are proliferating, and food banks' use is soaring. And of course, this is in a bleak global picture, where 1% of the population owns 45% of the world's wealth. And scientists tell us that we've got 3 years left until catastrophic climate change is unleashed. And obviously, there are countless more really terrifying and upsetting statistics. And they're all connected, and they are part of, they're symptomatic of deep structural issues. And together, they paint quite a clear picture that the political economic system of the last few decades, commonly known as neoliberalism, is breaking down. And one way to understand what is happening is that we're in the midst of a crisis of economic thinking or political economy. Now, 10 years ago, we had the crash, and the dominant school of economic thought, neoclassical economics, failed spectacularly to predict it. And then they failed to say actually how it happened and what we should do next. 10 years on, civil society has responded to an extent. Positive Money exists. Great organizations like the Finance Innovation Lab and New Economics Foundation have critiqued the financial sector. And great thinkers have written books critiquing the economic establishment, including Martin's excellent book, The Shifts and the Shocks. But in the halls of power, in the Bank of England, in Whitehall, neoclassical economic thinking still persists. The thinking that got us into this mess hasn't gone away. I was on a panel last week, another 10 years event, with a former FSA regulator who was there pre-crash, and he said everyone there believed markets were perfect. So much so that the industry is shrinking, so he actually left because he wanted to find a promotion somewhere. But so much so that this idea that markets were perfect meant that you couldn't challenge it, and if you did, you were laughed at. And the idea is hopefully absurd to everyone in this room. Like, markets are people, and people are certainly not perfect. But these macroeconomic and finance ideas that were part of the pre-crisis orthodoxy, whether it's the efficient market hypothesis or the rational expectations hypotheses, there's a plethora of evidence to show these aren't correct, but they still persist. And I think the failure to really question the financial markets in 2008 and turn the shock of the crash into a program of reform meant that the financial crisis very quickly morphed into a crisis of government spending. And across the world, we saw governments implementing austerity programs backed by the OECD and the IMF and other multilateral institutions so that the people that had done the least to cause the crash suffered the most. And it is clear that the establishment view has at least somewhat reverted to pre-crisis thinking. Mark Carney, the Bank of England governor, has recently made statements where he said that the UK should double the size of the financial sector over the next 25 years. He also said that the UK should become Europe's investment banker post-Brexit. Now, the idea that either of these things are in line with the Bank of England's mission, which is to promote the good of the people of the UK, is completely unfounded. There's absolutely no evidence that a large financial sector relative to the size of your economy results in better resource allocation or better returns for savers and investors. If anything, the opposite seems to be the case. The financial sector is inherently rent-seeking, and so its growth is
a result of extracting greater and greater rent from the rest of the economy. This should be a cause for concern and not celebration. So the city's contribution to growth and jobs, although often applauded by politicians, is vastly outweighed by financial instability. And the cost of the last crisis is estimated at £7.4 trillion to have costed the UK. And even if we look at bank lending and where it goes in the good times, how much of it goes into the productive economy, it's pretty dismal, with less than 10% of new loans going towards businesses. The vast majority is to property and financial markets, which results in the UK economy being skewed towards an oversized financial sector, housing bubbles, asset price inflation, and people are having to rely on taking on more and more debt to top up falling incomes. And despite delivering negligible social benefit, they still receive a massive public subsidy. As Martin spoke about, banks create money when they make loans, and they have this unique privilege. And they're able to do it in the knowledge that if any of those loans go bad, the state will step in to protect citizens' deposits. And this protection means that they can charge really high interest on loans, while at the same time not giving any return to depositors. And this public subsidy, the New Economics Foundation has estimated, is around £25 billion a year. And when there's a recession, the UK taxpayer, the state, will step in and bail them out, which was to the tune of over £130 billion in the crash. But obviously the cost, as I said earlier, was estimated at £7.4 trillion, a vast amount of money. So, what can we do? In the UK, we're dominated by five shareholder banks whose obvious interests are to their shareholders primarily, so that needs to change. But what we should be questioning now is our public institutions, the Bank of England, the Treasury, that should be putting society's interests first, whether they are. And there's a sense that the Bank of England and Treasury understand that we can't go back to pre-crisis finance. So Mark Carney caveated his statement about doubling the finance sector by saying that we need tough regulation. So he does think that the finance sector should be tamed but not changed. And there's clearly not been a discussion in any of those institutions around what is actually the purpose of finance. So my organisation, Positive Money, was founded with a radical vision to challenge the way money is created. And we quickly understood two things. That first of all, it was a bit of a taboo to talk about how money's created, less of a taboo now. And secondly, that there's a huge lack of knowledge in this area. And we witnessed that in the election early in the year when Theresa May questioned a nurse and said that the nurse didn't deserve a pay rise because there was no magic money tree. Now, clearly, it wasn't just Theresa May's lack of understanding of the monetary system that led her to make that statement. There's also political ideology at play. But very few people are aware that there are two large magic money trees. We have commercial banks, they create money when they make loans, and we have central banks. And central banks across the world have been creating vast amounts of money through quantitative easing since the crash. The way QE works is it floods financial markets with money, it creates money and buys financial assets from mostly government bonds. And the idea is that it should encourage bank lending, essentially trickle down. It doesn't work. And there's no evidence it's had a very good effect, and it is literally making the rich richer by boosting asset prices. Right after the crash, we probably could have forgiven this policy as maybe being the best tool available in a hurry. But when the Bank of England announced its expansion of QE last August after Brexit, and a policy they know will increase the wealth of the top 5% when wealth inequality is threatening social cohesion in the UK. The idea that that is the best that they can do, some of the brightest minds in this country, is completely unacceptable. So we know we need people to shift the debate, and so whilst we like holding debates with very intelligent people and getting the discussion about how we do reform, we also know people power matters. And so we've been, hopefully some people in this room were also with us outside the Bank of England twice. We've mobilised over 10,000 people, and we got the Treasury Select Committee to start an inquiry into monetary policy, questioning ideas like why are they doing corporate QE, where they pick corporations to buy bonds in? Why are they doing QE when they could be doing alternatives? Monetary financing, QE for people, there's also a range of options. Unfortunately, the inquiries got shelved because of the election, so now we are calling on Nicky Morgan, who's the new chair of the Treasury Select Committee, to reopen it. And I'd urge all of you to email your MP. I think you can do it via our website. But actually, these things matter, because in these turbulent and uncertain times, what is clear is that the most important and powerful macroeconomic institutions we have, central banks, are not being adequately scrutinised. And if what emerges from the current breakdown of the system does not seek to democratise central banks and does not seek to democratise the financial sector at large, then it's going to be very difficult for what to emerge to be fairer, more democratic, and more equal. Thank you. Thank you.